Hello, I'm Michael Stohr, Head of R&D here at Result, and in this video we would like to give a little overview of what we think precision of timekeeping equipment actually means. So, you know, in our slogan we actually advertise precision, and over the years we had many discussions of what precision of a timekeeping system actually is. And you may say, hey, that's that simple, that's how precise the time is measured. But actually it's not that simple. And I would like to actually split precision in three different categories. The first one is resolution. And with resolution, we mean how does the timing system store its data internally? How precise is the timestamp actually put into the memory? So resolution, you could compare, for example, for digital cameras with your megapixel count of your picture, does not necessarily mean that you have a high quality result. For your camera, for example, if you have a high resolution, if you have a crappy lens in front of your camera, resolution doesn't count at all. So it's actually quite easy to achieve a high resolution because it just means that you need to spend a little bit more memory on your timestamps. And when you put the results into a table, print to a thousand, to a 10,000, to a 100,000 of a second, but that does not really tell you a lot of how precise the result actually will be. So this figure is something you will always find in all the different data sheets because it's pretty easy to state, because you know as a designer how much memory you spent, and the typical resolution that you can find on timing systems would be a thousandth of a second, maybe a 10,000th of a second, and that's for all the sports that we do is plenty. Now, the second category I would like to talk about is the time base. So let's say we have a resolution of a 1,000th of a second. That means that we can store times in an interval of 1,000th. If two times are closer together, then they will be stored at the same 1,000th. And the minimum distance between two times that can be stored in memory would be 1,000th. Now, the question is, if you have two different timestamps several hours apart or between two different timing systems, is the time base precise enough to actually make use of the resolution? Because it would mean that, let's say you have a 24-hour race and you have two timestamps, one at the beginning, one at the end, and you have 24 hours between those. If you would want to make use of a 1,000th resolution, your time base needs to be precise to 1,000th within 24 hours. And I can tell you that's pretty difficult. That's actually why we use GPS synchronization. The GPS satellites have atomic clocks inside and they transmit the time. Actually, the time of the satellites is used for the GPS system, so it's really precise. But also, especially in our active systems, we have a temperature compensated crystal oscillator, which is also pretty precise, but it does not give you a thousandth of a day. Okay, that's a thousandth of a day is really, really difficult to achieve. And the time base is pretty critical for two different things. One is absolute synchronization of two different boxes. So you have a box A and a box B, start to finish. You want them to be exactly the same time, and this can only be achieved via GPS synchronization. And the drift over time or aging of the system of a time base if you have a lab system. So you have a system where it's only one time base, maybe not synchronized with anything, no GPS needed. But if you do a lap, what you want is that the time is precise no matter how long that lap is, whether it's 1 minute, which is pretty easy, or 24 hours. And you want that the same lap time is recorded now and in 5 years from now, after the system has aged. So therefore, the time base is critical. The last and most important part for us here is the accuracy of the timekeeping. And I have to explain a little bit what we mean with accuracy. So typically, as I said, in resolution, you have two participants coming through, maybe both in within 1,000s, and you believe, okay, they must have been over the finish line at exactly the same time. Unfortunately, it's not that easy. The problem is that the way we do timekeeping with transponders, there are some random effects in the data transmission and in the capability of the transponder to find out when it was over the finish line. And that creates some random variations which are dependent on the technology that you're using. And with accuracy, how we see it and how it is extremely simple to memorize is it is the minimum time that is needed between two participants so that we can be sure that we know who was first. Okay, so you have two participants coming through over the finish line. How far do they need to be apart in time so that we know who was first? That's how we see accuracy, and that's how it's stated in our data sheets. And if you look at the passive transponders, the passive system, which is based on UHF Gen 2, the accuracy is 0.2 seconds. This means that if you have more than 0.2 second time difference between two passings with the passive system, we know who was first. Actually, it's not that simple again, because there is some statistics involved. So if you have more than 0.2 between two passive detections, there is a very high likelihood, we believe something like 99%, that we know who was first. And if they're closer together, so if you only have 0.1 second between two passive passings, it is still quite likely that we got it right and knew who was first, but the statistics go down the closer the two passings are. You can imagine if they're really, really close, if there's only 1/1000th of a difference, it's really hard to tell who was first. So this is what we mean with accuracy. To give you some numbers, if you're looking at passive transponders, 0.2 seconds means at typical running speeds of 20 kilometers per hour, you will get about 1.1 meter between two transponders that we need to be sure to know who was first. So that's basically one running step, more or less. And that's the kind of accuracy you can expect from our passive system. The reason for that is that the communication with the chip is actually quite complex. There's lots going on. The timing system is talking to multiple chips at the same time, maybe some chips which are not even participating in the race by standing next to the finish line. There's lots of things going on the air interface, which does not give us the ability to read this tag more often, which we would need to have higher accuracy. So 0.2 seconds, 1.1 meter at typical running speeds. Now looking at the active system, the active transponder has the benefit that the transponder itself does the timekeeping, determines the higher signal strength over the loop. And if the loop is set up correctly, meaning you are using the minimum possible power and you have a narrow loop and you have a controlled way of mounting the transponders, you can get an accuracy of down to 0.01 seconds. So 0.01 seconds means at typical running speeds of 20 kilometers per hour, you get about 1.1 centimeters. Okay. So the resolution of the active transponder is actually tuned for higher speeds. So if you are looking at 60 kilometers per hour, a typical road race cycling finish line speed, we are talking about 16 centimeters. And this gives you a good indication of where you will need to use a finish line camera. Because 16 centimeters, something like this, like 6 inches. So if you have a road race cycling finish where you expect people to come by closer than this distance, it is highly recommended to use an additional finish line camera, because this kind of distance between two participants may be too far for a very close finish on a road race cycling event. Still, 1/100th of a second repeatable accuracy is quite hard to achieve. And I invite you to test this yourself. If you have any timing system, especially any active system, the way you can test this is you take two transponders and tape them together and throw them over a loop or antenna or whatever, how your system works. And what you would expect is that they report the same time. And maybe if you do this a few times, they will sometimes report the same time, but there will be variances. And this is what we call accuracy. As soon as you see the variances coming up, you get a feeling of, you know, those two transponders should have had the same time, but they won't have. And you get a feeling of what the accuracy of your timing system actually is. And we're proud to achieve 1/100th of a second true repeatable accuracy. And we believe it's pretty difficult to achieve more than that with this kind of technology. Of course, if you go into motorsport technology where you have power transponders and things like that, you can be more precise. But for a transponder like this, 1/100th of a second, to our belief, is actually pretty difficult to achieve as repeatable accuracy. Okay, so let's go through this again. How do we define precision? So precision is based on three different things. Precision is based on resolution of your internal data storage. It's based on the time base, basically ticking the clock in your timing system, whether it's drifting over time or if it's synchronized between two or more different boxes. And the accuracy, meaning how close together can two participants be and we still know who was first. Yeah, I hope that this brings more clarity to the questions of precision. And I'm actually hoping that we can somehow reduce the discussions that we have about resolution, okay? Because many people who do not think about this a lot always talk about resolution. And resolution, yes, it is important to have some kind of resolution, you know, to have maybe on your digital camera 15 megapixels or something. But for real world applications, it does not help to have the 50 megapixel camera anymore. There is no big difference in real world image quality. And it's the same with timing systems. As soon as you are at 1000 and below, these other problems or topics are much more critical and important than resolution of your timing system. And yes, it would be easy to bump the resolution up by just spending a little bit more memory, but what does it help if you don't have the precise time base and you don't have the accuracy to actually make use of that additional data? So, I hope that this gives you a good overview, and see you in the next video.